So I'm really excited to be here today. As you heard in my introduction, and you'll hear more when I show the excerpt of my documentary. It's not completed, but I'm still working on it, so we'll watch about 20 minutes of it. But it was really a passion project for me. When I went to Ivory Coast, I didn't go to Ivory Coast with the intention of filming a documentary. I went there to do a Fulbright, to work at the Ministry of Justice, to do research, which was an amazing experience, and this happened as an aside. So some of the themes that I talk about in the documentary focus on identity. Identity has been a huge part of my life, has been important to my life, how I see myself, how I construct myself. And so throughout the conversations that I had, I wanted to figure out, how do you actually define identity for yourself? How did Ivorian women define their identities? Through their hair. How is it really constructed? Is it something that a community puts on you in terms of identity? Do you construct your own identity? And also, I wanted to ask questions about what implications does identity have on access to resources and privileges?
In 2013, I decided to move back to Côte d'Ivoire, Abidjan, or better known as Ivory Coast, Abidjan. I had grown up there for 10 years, having moved there with my family, my mother being a Black American and my father being an Ivorian. I grew up surrounded by extended family made up of uncles, cousins, and aunts, and other extended family. I was truly raised by a village. The weather was amazing, the food even better. I learned about the history and the culture of Ivory Coast. When I left Ivory Coast to return to the United States, I had a strong sense of self and a grounded identity. In 2013, I was awarded a Fulbright Clinton Fellowship in Public Policy to study at the Ministry of Justice in Ivory Coast. I was excited about my return, apprehensive about what it would look like reintegrating in a society that had raised me for more than 10 years of my life. I understood that I wanted to get support for me in one of the personal aspects of my life, which was my natural hair. Having grown up in that country, I understood the different nuances, sometimes not so positive, of what natural hair could be depicted as you see in the media. I found a community of women, Napis de Babi, natural and happy, that helped support me through my journey as I reintegrated back into Ivorian society. Women that had decided to going back to wearing their natural hair. So I started to notice a phenomenon. When I would leave work every day trying to catch my cab home, women would ask me, "Is that all your hair?" So I started having conversations, dialogues, interviews, sister circles, trying to figure out where this idea that a Black woman couldn't grow natural hair, or it was something that was different. There was lots of laughter. There was conversations, sister building. And I was able to discover some of the ways in which beauty shows up in a society when it's been exported from another place in the world. There were questions about how my hair did what it did, why it did what it did, and so I thought that these questions were really interesting and I wanted to document them. Working at the Ministry of Justice was my day job, but as soon as I was done, I would interview women that were interested in finding out how my hair functioned, and we had conversations. And so I think that this was a really interesting conversation for us to have, because as an African-American woman, both African and African-American, a lot of African-Americans look back to the motherland, Africa, for answers in terms of roots. And so I thought that it was mind-boggling as to why it seemed as though it was the opposite. I was looking at someone who would be considered an ancestor who was confused as to how my natural hair did what it did. So I wanted to figure out and find out why. One of the first interviews that I did was with a young woman where I asked her a question if she preferred to have her hair natural, permed, or weaved up. And she said, I prefer it natural or nappy. And I asked her why. And she simply responded, because I'm black. The conversation continued as we talked about identity, what it meant to identify as a black woman within the diaspora, specifically an Ivorian woman. And a lot of the conversations were really, really funny. I started going into salons and having conversations with women that were getting their hair done as to why they were going back to being natural. I continued to do interviews asking young women, well, why is it that they were so surprised that natural hair could exist the way that it did on top of my head? And the answers were really interesting. She explained to me that this phenomenon was something that developed from being a young child, having her hair permed or having extensions put in because that's what she saw around her. When she was young, her sisters, her aunts, her mothers all had straight hair, so it was something that was just normalized, and that's what you just did. And so when I continued to go to natural hair salons that were popping up, one of my friends actually opened up one. Women started to discover what it could actually feel like, look like, to understand how to care for your natural hair and what that experience could look like in a society that didn't necessarily feel as though you could have access to resources if you did not fit the normal mold. And so that was a little problematic for some people. I remember getting a lot of pushback with conversations with women. I interviewed women who were the keepers of culture, who were the keepers of history, who told me interesting anecdotes about who does it benefit when African women do not keep their hair in its natural state. We talked about capitalism and the effect of consumerism in Africa and what that looks like as well. I continue to have conversations with young women that express what beauty standards look like for them, how it affected their self-esteem, and how they moved in society, depending on the types of jobs that they could apply for. I also wanted to make sure that I included younger women, girls. I wanted to hear about their perceptions and their reactions to natural hair. What did it look like for them? How were they experiencing identity and belonging through their hair? It was really important to also make sure that it was balanced in terms of going to natural hair care salons and asking women what their perceptions were of their hair, why did they go natural, why did they use to perm, why did they do weaves. And so I wanted to also make sure that I went to salons where perms were done, weaves were put in. A really good friend of mine allowed me to film her going to the salon and getting her weave put in to see the whole process of what that looks like, but to also look at different images that are portrayed, that are exported from other parts of the world to West Africa, specifically to Ivory Coast, and how that has to do with the way that women see themselves in terms of access to power, access to beauty, access to resources. What I also thought was really interesting was a juxtaposition between this little girl who was getting her hair done at the same time that my friend was getting her weave put in. Looking at how beauty standards are reinforced in little girls as young as 3 or 4 is really interesting to see how certain ideas, certain beauty standards are exported from outside of West Africa and how they have an impact on self-esteem. When I moved back to the United States at 12 years old, these were the images that I also saw. These were the images that represented beauty, desire to me, a sense of attractiveness, to be included in a society that had relegated
black women to a part where they were not deemed attractive or desirable. So these images are now being exported over to, quote unquote, the motherland in Africa, and are affecting the way that women see themselves and how they show up in society.
So although I started this journey feeling apprehensive about what kind of judgment I would receive because of the way that I look, specifically my hair, within a very traditional field of law at the Ministry of Justice where I was doing my Fulbright, I ended up finding out that when you stand within your power and you stand within what feels good to you and how to show up in your physical appearance and your own authenticity, you give power to others to be able to do the same and start to ask questions as to why the status quo is the way that it is. Ways to start to break down some of the negative impacts of the status quo regarding natural hair in Ivory Coast is to build a counterculture, which is exactly what Nappies de Babi started doing. And in a sense, it started to transform the way that women see themselves. To the original question that actually prompted the making of this documentary, is that all your hair? What do you think? You'll have to watch the rest of the documentary to figure out if it really is.